us this evening for this Wednesday night service. Today we want to begin the service with prayer. We've got several out not well tonight and want to be real mindful of them. But let's just pray the Lord bless us with a good service this evening. God's so good, isn't he?
Yes.
Brother James, begin our service.
Our Heavenly Father, O Lord God Almighty, we are so thankful and grateful to gather here in your house tonight. Lord, we just thank you for the blessings of the day and for all your blessings that you bestow on us each day. And Lord, we do want to remember those that are sick and afflicted this evening that can't be here. And there'll be many that will be mentioned here shortly that are on our hearts. Many need your touch, Lord, and they need a miracle that only you can give them. And Lord, we just pray that your will be done in each life. Lord, we pray for Sister Vicky's family and their time of bereavement tonight. And Lord, just pray for our lost loved ones, dear God. There's so many unconcerned about eternity. Lord, how we pray for open doors to share the gospel message with them. And Lord, we're looking forward to our revival services here in a couple weeks. Bless Brother Doyle. Give him the messages that we need to hear, dear God. And we pray for revival. Lord, I pray for revival in my own heart. And we pray for revival in this nation, dear God. And Lord, how we pray for our leaders and our government. And Lord, just tonight we pray for Brother Larry, for your anointing upon him and the message you've given him. Lord, may if there's a need here tonight, may it be met in an altar of prayer. And may we all just draw closer to you and be obedient to the word of God. We'll give you the praise and the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, glad you joined us tonight. Saturday visitation, 10 o'clock, Saturday morning. Looking forward to that. If the Lord carries till Sunday, we're praying for some good church Sunday.
Amen.
And praying for a great day in God's house. Still thanking the Lord. Good services last week. Hey, before I forget, I need to announce this. Bullier's Funeral Home called yesterday. You know, the officer that passed away that was shot. That'll be a procession from Bullier's Sunday morning at 9, going all the way to Carthage, Missouri. And it'll be quite a procession. And so they'll be actually coming through. They're going to make a few variations through the town of Bonterre and hit 67 and then south. But there could be, that starts at 9. So just kind of keep an eye on the streets, whatever, however you're coming to church for Sunday school, because there could be some roads blocked and that kind of thing. So just wanted to give you a heads up on that. Most of you probably won't affect at all, but just in case. If you come across a whole crowd of cars, you know it's not an accident. It's just the funeral procession. And sure, we want to be mindful of all that family and our Bonterre police as we pray tonight. Looking for a great day Sunday. Here's some prayer requests. This isn't all of them, so help me out, okay? We're just down at Cozine's sister Vicky, her niece, did pass away, went home to be with the Lord, Donna Bullier, and we had prayed for her for a long time. So just remember that family as we pray. I want to pray for Rick and Dawn's daughter with a blood clot, Dawn's mother in the hospital with kidneys not doing well. Remember Brother Rich. Remember Brother Dwight. Remember Sister Sharon. Remember Lana having a pretty rough week these last several days. Remember her. Continue to pray for Norman and Colette and all the family out in Colorado. Jim and Yvonne, remember them as we pray. Brother James has got surgery coming up in about a week.
Monday.
Oh, it's Monday.
5 days.
So remember Brother James getting his knee fixed Monday. I feel like I need to go get one fixed with you. I stood in such a long line down at Cozine's, just standing still. Now my knee's trying to take out on me.
Talk to Dr. Holden to take
we could take a whole wing at the hospital, couldn't we? But remember all these. Yeah, then Martha's got her knee surgery toward the end of May. Right. Remember Brother Herb, and he did get some good results with his test. Doctor said, whatever you're doing, keep doing it. So, Doris, whatever you're doing to him, keep doing to him, you know. And but we thank the Lord for that. Remember Sister Shirley? Shirley, how'd you turn out?
Well, there's a spot on my liver, but it's a pretty
Okay. Okay. We was here praying for you in the traffic. Yeah, I know. Remember Shirley. Help me out. Who else would you like to remember in prayer here this evening? I've probably not mentioned.
Cheryl talked to Kendra this evening. She's sick.
Okay, remember Kendra? Yes. Remember these? Who? Alberta. Remember Alberta? All right, remember Logan. Yeah, Ronnie? Larry Redmond. Who else? Yes. Okay, who else? Yes. Remember Charlene. Charlene Husky. Linda Teasley. Yes, remember Sister Linda. Any others on here?
Leon?
Did you do tests? Okay, Friday. Okay. The Higgins family. And did Anna leave today?
Yesterday.
Okay, good. Good. Anyone else? Matt? Oh, okay.
Paul? Debbie Anderson.
Yeah. Right. Good. So remember Debbie. Yes. She gave me one.
Charlene.
Yeah, Charlene. Any others? I had a lot of prayer requests. Pray for revival. Hey, week and a half away. Pray for Brother Doyle as he comes. The Lord will just bless in a real, real special way. God bless you tonight. Good to see all of you. Let's sing a song.
Going to be up there, Matt? Okay. What's the first one? Huh? I don't care. Huh? Mansion on a Hilltop. What's that? 367? Nope, that's not it. Cottage below, a little silver and a little gold, and that my city still shines on a mansion that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. Though often tempted, tormented and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow a stone. And though I find here no permanent dwelling, I know he'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we
will never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold. Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold.
2/3. Amazing Grace, okay.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. The Lord has been so good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Many dangers, toils, and snares I have already come. 'Twas grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
176.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
333.
I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross He suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost estate to save. In His boundless love and mercy, He the ransom freely gave. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will praise my dear Redeemer, His triumphant power I'll tell. How the victory He giveth over sin and death and hell. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will sing of my Redeemer and His heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with Him to be. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free.
Knee a break.
tell me of a home far beyond the skies. They tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Tell me of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded bay. Tell me of a home where my friends have gone. They tell me of a land far away, where the tree of life in eternal bloom sheds its fragrance through the unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me of a king in his beauty there. Tell me of the one shall behold, where he sits on a throne that is whiter than snow, in a city that is made of gold. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. They tell me of his smiles on his children there. His smiles from his sorrows away. And they tell me that no tears ever come again in that lovely land of an unclouded day. Oh, the land of cloudless days. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
Ever thought about what it's going to be like when we stand face to face to our Savior, our Redeemer? We can only imagine. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever
forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Oh, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
We're just going to leave it there. We can only imagine. Only imagine what that music would have sounded like.
The good news is they're installing the new sound system next Monday.
Amen.
Long time coming. Finally, everything's here, and Matt will be able to be over here when we get it installed. We'll be in good shape then, hopefully. Just in time for revival, right? Listen, we want to look at some scripture tonight. Herb's already reminded me, not a full crowd, so no need to share the full load. Appreciate the encouragement, Brother Herb. I got to have a little fun. Hey, 1 Samuel. Turn in your Bible, the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 1. You know, what could we expect for revival? What is your expectations for revival? Is it something we can get out of it? Is it something we can receive that would, you know, just be an extra type of a spiritual blessing? Is revival what we can get out of it? And don't get me wrong, I believe we get a lot out of a revival. But I think the real common goal of revival is not what we get out of it. I believe it's that God gets something out of it. God deserves glory. And God ought to receive glory. And if there's a revival take place here or any other church anywhere, it'll be because God is glorified. And that's what we want to just talk about for just a little while. This evening. And Brother Herb, I may not give the whole load because my voice is about shot and I haven't even started yet. But anyway, let's see how far we can go here. You know, what is important in revival? Well, we know some of the essential ingredients that I think plays an important part in revival. Prayer. I don't believe revival comes where folks aren't praying. I believe another ingredient, forgiveness. Hey, there'll be forgiveness. And if there's folks that aren't forgiving each other for this or that, or maybe grudges on even somebody outside the church. And listen, if there's something wrong in your heart, God's going to have a hard time doing something for you. So there needs to be prayer. Needs to be forgiveness. And I said one of the most important ingredients, the main common goal, is that God receive all the glory. The scripture I want to look at tonight, I just ran across this again just the other day. I was reading in the book of 1 Samuel, and it just Hannah. You know, Hannah just kind of stands out in the scripture. Hannah prayed. You know, think about that. She prayed. 1 Samuel chapter 1, and I believe we're going to begin reading in verse 2. Okay, verse 2 through verse 8. And he had two wives. The name of one was Hannah. The name of the other was Peninnah. Peninnah had children. But Hannah had no children. She was barren. And this man went up out of the city yearly to worship and to sacrifice unto the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. And when the time was that Elkanah offered, he gave to Penanai his wife and all her sons and her daughters portions. But unto Hannah he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hannah. But the Lord had shut up her womb. And her adversary also provoked her sore, for to make her fret because the Lord had shut up her womb. And as he did so year by year when she went up to the house of the Lord, so she provoked her. Therefore she wept and did not eat. Then said Elkanah, her husband, to her, Hannah, why weepest thou? Why eatest thou not? Why is thy heart grieved? Am I not better to thee than 10 sons? And read on with me. So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul, and prayed unto the Lord, and wept sore. Brother Herb, would you pray for the preaching, please? Amen. Amen. You know, Hannah prayed. This man in the Bible by the name of Elkanah had two wives, Hannah and Penaniah. Penaniah had children. Hannah had none. She was barren. And we saw in the scripture, and Penaniah seemed to make things hard on her. Kind of mocked her for that, didn't she? And Hannah, with a broken heart, tells us in verse 10 that it was in bitterness of soul she prayed unto the Lord and wept sore. Now notice, she prayed with a burden. She prayed with a great burden on her heart and in her soul. And you know, we think about revival and we think about what we need in our families. Hey, I got some loved ones need to get saved. Many of you do also. There's many needs each one of us may experience as something worthy of prayer. And just really, Hannah stands out in the scripture this evening as a woman with such a burden and such a prayer to her Lord. Look what it says in verse 11. And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou will indeed look on the affliction of thy handmaid and remember me, and not forget thy handmaid, but will give unto thy handmaid a man-child. Then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head. You know, she was specific. She wasn't just praying for a baby. She was praying for a man-child. She was praying for a little boy. But in her vow, she not only prayed, and Lord, if you'll give me this man-child, you know what she said? And Lord, I'll give him back to you. Wow. I mean, there's a mother's prayer there with a burden. And you know what? In her concern, I believe this whole thing is we're going to see that God received glory. All she wanted the comfort of knowing she could have a child, and the comfort of knowing that God would bless her with a child, but she wanted God to be glorified. And so then she, in her vow, Lord, and I'll give him back to you. Notice that's, I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life. And so there's her prayer. There's the burden of her heart, and she's crying out. Now, verses 12 to 14, she is misunderstood by Eli the priest. She's praying, and Eli's watching her. And you know what he thinks? He thinks she's drunk. No, she's just pouring her heart out to God. But look at verses 12 through 14. And it came to pass, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli marked her mouth. He watched her. Now Hannah, she spake in her heart. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she had been drunken. And Eli said unto her, how long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee. So there's a real misunderstanding. Man, she's crying out to God with the burden of her soul. And the first thing the priest thinks is she's drunk. You know, sometimes we can be misunderstood too. Maybe not in the same way like this. But you know what? We could be doing something sincere for God and be misunderstood by someone else, be judged by someone else. And he judged her, said, you know, why are you drunk? And notice what we find here is Hannah begins to share with the man of God the reason for the sorrow in her prayer. Look at 15 and 16. And Hannah answered and said, no, my Lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Count not thy handmaid for a daughter of Belial, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. Hey, Eli may not have been able to hear the words of her prayer. All he saw was the mouth moving. But I tell you what, there was a God in heaven that was hearing the words of her mouth. Heard every prayer, the request, the burden of her heart. Oh, she poured out her soul to the God of heaven, and she's letting him know, listen, I've not had wine, I've not had strong drink. I'm just pouring out my soul to God in prayer. But then notice we find Hannah, she's prayed, she has trusted her need into the hands of God, and I believe God is going to give her confirmation. Look at verse 17 and 18. Then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked of him. What'd she ask for? Man-child. And now Eli says that the God of Israel will grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked for. And she said, let thy handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. Now, she is not pregnant yet. She's not showing any signs of a woman that's going to give birth. But when she walked away from there, she was sad no more. God confirmed something in her heart. I mean, that she got a confirmation from heaven that I'm going to get what I prayed for. She poured out her soul to God, and God gave her exactly what she had prayed for. And it says, so she went away, and her countenance was no more sad. Hey, wouldn't it be great if we could be like that? Put things in the hands of God. and then just walk away in a right spirit and with joy and victory, knowing, you know what? God's got this. God's going to take care of this. And may not always see the quick answer or immediate results, but wouldn't it be amazing if we could have that kind of faith to pray and put it in God's hands and just walk away knowing it's settled? Man, I like that. I like that. That's really what she experienced, I believe. And then if you look at 19 through 23, she now receives the son of promise. Look at 19. And they rose up in the morning early and worshiped before the Lord and returned and came to their house, to Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. Wherefore, notice, wherefore it came to pass, when the time was come about after Hannah had conceived, that she bare a son, called his name Samuel, saying, because I have asked him of the Lord. And the man Elkanah and all his house went up to offer unto the Lord the yearly sacrifice and his vow. But Hannah went not up, for she said unto her husband, I will not go up until the child be weaned. Then I will bring him, that he may appear before the Lord and there abide forever. I tell you what, God kept his part. And you know what? Hannah's now going to keep her part. She says, I'm not ready to go to the temple yet, but as soon as this man child is weaned, I will take him there and give him back to the Lord. And there's where he'll be the days of his life. She meant business. Listen, as we pray for revival and for loved ones and for growth and for new families, we need to mean business. We need to be that serious with God and knowing that God is able to deliver. God is able to bless. So she receives the son of promise. I mean, you know what? It might, at first instinct, it might have looked kind of selfish, but it was not. It was not a selfish prayer. I know the other wife was giving her a hard way to go, so it might look a little selfish. But listen, her prayer to God was for God to be glorified. That's why she included in the vow that the son would be given back to the Lord. And boy, I tell you what he was, and God used him, didn't he? Samuel. So she kept her vow. Look at verses 24 through 27. Hannah keeps her vow to the Lord. And listen, when we make God's promises, we need to keep our vows too, church. In verse 24, and when she had weaned him, she took him up with her with three bullocks and one ephah of flour, a bottle of wine, and brought him into the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. And they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. And she said, O my Lord, as thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here, praying unto the Lord. It's for this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petitions, which I asked of him. And then finally, look at verse 28. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord, and he worshiped the Lord there. Just as soon as the child Samuel was weaned, she took him to God's house. And it was there she offered him up to the Lord to be there forever. God answered her prayer. And I like the way that word lent. And she lent him to the Lord. Understand this tonight. Hannah's son Samuel did not belong to her. He was the Lord's. Amen? And God blessed her with this son. And now Hannah lent Samuel back to the Lord as long as he liveth. You know, I'm becoming more and more aware every day of my life that I don't own anything. Are you with me? Oh, we've accumulated some things. We could sit down and make a list of things that we seemingly possess. But every day I get older, I realize I don't own anything. You know what? The Lord just lent it to me for a while. And the things that we possess, Think of it like this too. We've lent them to the Lord. I mean, this whole thing's about bringing God glory, isn't it? That God receive glory. Everything we have, God has lent to us. How long? Well, kind of like Samuel. Samuel was lent to the Lord as long as he liveth. And the things that we possess, you know what, have been lent as long as we live. As long as we live. Our body, our possession, our finances, our car, our house. We need to be good stewards of all this because it's not yours. God owns it all. Somebody say amen. We don't own it. God's lent it to us as long as we liveth. But we ought to take good care of it because it's God's. It's God's. Just as Samuel was God's. Yeah, so and as we grow in our faith, something else kind of comes to mind more and more often. And we preached the other night on growing old gracefully. And I'm just saying tonight, the older we get, I think we do start realizing more things. It's more important to be heavenly minded than earthly minded. Have you figured that out yet? Is it starting to become more important to you? Here's a scripture over in Colossians, and I'm going to go over there and read it. It's a great verse. I love to read it quite often. Colossians 3, 1 and 2. Paul said this. He said, if you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Verse 2, love this verse. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. And what I've learned, the more I set my affection on things above, the more God takes care of my things on earth. Okay? As long as I'm putting God first up there, He's helping me down here. I believe that. So, you know, we become less concerned about the things we possess, only lent to us as long as we liveth, and then we won't need them any longer. You know, and what's this all about tonight? It's about revival. It's about revival and our great need tonight to seek God. I want to get something out of revival, and I believe that I will. But as I said in the beginning, revival is not about just coming to get what we can get. Revival is getting ourselves in a right attitude, in a right spirit, in a right frame of mind that we want to give God all that we can. And I think that's when God gives revival. When we pour our heart out to Him. Oh, listen. Let God be. God was glorified through Samuel. And yes, you know what? Samuel did serve the Lord the rest of the days of his life. Hannah's prayer stuck, didn't it? I mean, not only did she get the man child, and she gave him to the Lord, and he served the Lord all the days of his life. Oh, Samuel. Understand this. Hannah prayed. Now go back to our text. We went through much of 1 Samuel chapter 1. And now I want you to look at chapter 2, just the first two verses. What's Hannah going to do now? She's going to pray. She's going to sing a song of thanksgiving. Look at the first two verses. Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoiceth in the Lord. Mine heart is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is enlarged over mine enemies, because I rejoice in thy salvation. There is none holy as the Lord, for there is none beside thee, neither is there any rock like our God. What's she doing? She's praising God. She's giving God glory. She's giving God all the glory. And you know what? Her intentions was right on. They were spot on. And what is our intentions for having a good revival here at Gospel Light? It ought not be for self-glory. And it ought not be for selfish reasons. It must be to give God glory. I love that hymn we sing a lot. Number 19 in the hymn book. To God be the glory, great things He hath done. Man, praise the Lord. I like that song. So we're praying for revival. And part of my prayer is, God, you be glorified. If somebody gets saved, we've been praying for, is there anything we could do in a service or see happen in a service that would bring God more glory than seeing somebody get saved? If we see some backslider that's been away from God and come back to an altar and rededicate their life and get back on fire for God again, hey, renew their vows, get their victory back, get their joy back. Is there anything in a service that could bring more glory to God than something like that happening? Listen, I believe that's the fruits of revival. I believe that's what God wants to do for us. I mean, brought to a place that we're made alive, revived in the work of God and in the ministry for God. Oh, to see loved ones saved, God be glorified. See God touch somebody, God be glorified. Somebody gets healed. We've seen folks healed. If somebody gets healed in one of our services, hey, God be glorified. It's for Him. Amen? And so Hannah prayed, and God answered her prayer with a son. His name was Samuel. And she gave that son to the Lord all the days of his life, just like she vowed. And you know, the things that we have, we need to give to the Lord also. Oh, that we might give ourselves to the Lord completely. That, hey, Romans 12:1-2, remember, I beseech you, be a living sacrifice. Want to give something to God? Give yourself to Him. Give ourselves to Him as a sacrifice for Him tonight. So as we approach revival, I'm just saying, I know we're always praying for our loved ones. Why don't we pray with the burden that Hannah prayed with? With her soul literally crying out to God, let us pray like that for our lost loved ones. Oh, that God would get glory through all of this. Pray for the burden of Hannah. Pray with the commitment of Hannah. Wouldn't hurt to even make a vow like Hannah, would it? Oh, listen. And when God answers prayer, pray a prayer of thanksgiving, just like Hannah did in chapter 2. Verse 1 and 2. The road to revival, it'll be paved with prayer, sincerity, forgiveness, and the common goal that God be glorified. Can you say amen? Amen. Father, we come to you tonight in Jesus' name. Lord, just a simple message you laid on our heart, and Lord, we cannot help but notice when Hannah prayed, what a prayer that was. The burden of her heart, prayed her soul out to you. And Lord, you gave her confirmation. She got up and the sorrow was gone and the burden was gone. And Lord, when she walked away, she knew that you had taken care of business for her. Lord, I pray we might pray with that kind of a spirit in us tonight, that kind of a trust, that kind of a confidence in our God, that Lord, when we place these things in your hands, Lord, you'll take care of this for us. We are praying for great revival, praying for Brother Darrell as he comes, and Lord, as he preaches the Word of God, I pray by our, Lord, by our actions, and Lord, by our commitments, Lord, by the desires of our heart, I pray, Lord, we'll see you receive glory for all things. We thank you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know if it's the full load or a half load or a little load, but that's all I had, Herb. All right. God bless you. Good church on this Wednesday night. Hey, you know what? I love midweek church. Amen.